most of, probably all of you have done the molecular simulation, but so maybe some students who are beginner for the molecular simulation. So this is an very brief introduction to the molecular simulation. So if you already know it very well, so please bear with me. So I'm going to go through it very quickly just to get an idea from it. Okay, so what is molecular simulation? So basically, molecular simulation will base on the numerical solving equations that express, those equations express fundamental physical laws that govern molecular interaction. So basically, you solve for the molecular interactions, and then that will allow you to be able to measure or quantify the collective behaviors of your materials. So why would you do it? Why would you do molecular simulation? So because you would like to understand the nature of your materials. You want to predict how your materials would behave. And also molecular simulation is a very, very great tool to act as a supplement to the real experiment. So you can use it to help experimentalists to understand the phenomenon that happens in the system. So these are some of the properties that you can use molecular simulation to predict or measure or even quantify it. But these are just some of it. So you can get the molecular structure. You can calculate for spectra like IR or Raman. You can looking at the kinetics properties and thermodynamic properties. You looking at electronic structure, band gap, HOMO, LUMO, and also other properties that it would be extremely difficult to get in the experiment, like molecular orbitals or bond order. So it is a very helpful and useful tool. So you all know, you know that. So I would like to just introduce three of the main approaches that we use in molecular simulation, particularly in a computational chemistry. So the first one is a lot of you have been using it, is the quantum mechanics. So I will go through a little bit about the ab initio calculation and the FT calculation. And molecular dynamics, and the last one is the hybrid method between ab initio and molecular dynamics, or AIMD. So let's start with the first one, quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics, or you can say it's the electronic structure method. Quantum mechanics is a fundamental theory in physics that describes nature at the smallest scales of energy levels of atoms. So basically, you have the main equation, which is a time-independent Schrodinger equation. So you know this equation, so the H with a hat is a Hamiltonian operator. So this term is the operator that associates with all the observable energy terms in the system. And the psi is the wave function, which is a function of the position of all electrons and nuclei in the system. And E is the total energy. So you know this equation, but how to solve this equation is very difficult. So all this energy in your system that will be expressed in the Hamiltonian operator will include of both kinetic and potential energy terms. So when you lay out all the energy term, you would have kinetic energy of the nuclei and electrons in your system. You will have the potential, the interaction potential, which has the nuclei-nuclei repulsion interaction, nuclei-electron attraction, electron-electron repulsions. So each of these terms just simply a function of coordinates of nuclei and electrons, all of them in your system. So to solve that equation, the most difficult one is the term that describes the electron-electron interaction. So actually, the Schrödinger equation well, cannot be solved exactly. So to be able to solve it, we make a lot of they make some of approximations that would be required. So that those even they do the approximation solutions on the equation, but it's still difficult and computational expensive to solve even with a small number of molecules in your system. So the approximation that we do in order to solve the equation, so you probably hear a lot when you do the ab initio calculation, the words say level of theory and basis set. So the level of theory is basically give you, those are the approximation method to the Hamiltonian. And the basis sets, those are the approximation to the wave function. So for example, you use the method HF631GD. This means you use the level of theory is the Hartree-Fock method, and the 631GD is your basis set that you choose. What you choose for the level of theory and basis set are very important for your results accuracy and the computational time that would require to run your system. So if you have a higher level of theory to apply in your system, then you would your result and higher basis set, so your result would be quite accurate, but you also need to be able to afford relatively high computational cost. For the DFT method, so DFT, what they do is they give the approximate Hamiltonian, which is expressed in the term of the total density of electron. And electron density would give you a measure of the probability to find an electron. I will talk a little bit more of the DFT in the next session. So I will go quickly here. So this is just give you an idea that we have so many choices to do the quantum mechanics calculation. So these are some of the both are freewares and commercial software. So and it depends on your choices, and I think it work in on a different system, the suitable system. But okay, today so we will target to use WAVS. So the second one that I would like to introduce a little bit about is the molecular dynamics or MD. So MD, as you've seen in the quantum mechanics, we solve the Schrodinger equation. But in MD, we ignore the electronic degree of freedom. So you don't treat electrons and nuclei individually. So the nuclei and electrons are lumped in together like atom-like particles. And these particles are treated as masses, and the bonds between particles as springs. So with appropriate force constant, the interactions of atoms are based on springs and classical potential that you probably we know very well in the Newtonian physics law, F=ma. So the interatomic potential are described by force field. So in MD simulation, force field is quite a very important term because it refers to the functional form and parameter sets that used to calculate the potential energy in your system. So to choose a suitable force field to your system is very important in the MD simulation. So because of MD don't treat like an atom-like particle, so it can handle thousands of atoms, And it's very useful tools for a lot of people who work in like biochemists, that they're looking at segment of DNA or proteins that which the molecule are quite large. And also as a material science, we also use this method to be able to apply the expressive solvent in the system as well. Because of, and you can see in the name, it's dynamic, so it can give you the to investigate the time-dependent behavior or even non-equilibrium phenomena. But however, in this MD simulation, it can only give you to the ground states of your system. The lots of MD software available as well, but that we have used a lot in the material science. I think it's a GROMAX and LAMS and NAMD that we heard a lot about this software. So the last one is the hybrid method between ab initio and molecular dynamics. AIMD, so you see, it's basically, instead of you, in the MD, you use the force field to describe the interatomic potential. But in the AIMD, they solve that as like you see in the quantum mechanics. So they basically they solve Schrodinger equation for this, for the interatomic potentials. So, and then from this quantum mechanics ab initio method, so they give force to, and then it can go to the Newtonian physics law, and then it update the nuclei coordinates back to calculate the interatomic potential. So this method is because it's both the dynamic and it's also both, it's still the principle is still ab initio in the part. So it's very expensive in terms of the time, computational time that you would require to do it, even more expensive than the ab initio. So in this method, if you're going to work on it, so you have to really carefully balance between your resource accuracy, your system size, and your computational resources you have. So these are some of the summaries of the three main approaches in the molecular simulation. Okay, ready to go to DFT next? Okay, so I think a lot of, most of you probably work on the DFT. So I, this is a brief introduction to like maybe refresh some of the fundamental. Okay, so we, DFT, we solve Schrodinger equation as well. But we already know that it's difficult to solve this equation. So we make some approximation to allow us to be able to solve that. So the first approximation they use is basically you separate a mathematical problem. So this is called Born-Oppenheimer approximation. So in this approximation, they say that nuclei are much more massive than electrons and move much slower than electrons. So we can neglect the kinetic term of the nuclei, and we can solve for the fixed position of the atomic nuclei. So the nuclei-nuclei interactions and nuclei kinetic energy now is not our problems. But to solve this equation, we need to describe the electron's motion. So what we left off is still involved, the difficult term still does involve electrons. And the most critical one still be this one, electron-electron interactions. So just to give you an idea how complex it is, like for example, you have one CO2 molecule in your system. You carbon has 6 electrons, oxygen has 8 electrons, so you have total 22 electrons in your system. All 22 electrons move 3 dimensions, So total, you have 66 dimensions. And if you're looking at gold cluster, 50 atoms, now you're dealing with gold has 79 electrons. You have 79 times 50 and times 3 dimension. You end up with 11,850 dimensions. This is too many degree of freedom. It's so you can have that picture. So the next approximation they require, they do is, now they approximate the total wave function. So instead of the total, the electron wave function is the function of each of the coordinates of each of the n electrons. So now we make approximation on the solution of the total wave function, which is, can be written as a product of the individual electron wave functions in this term, as a product term. So this is called Hartree product. And each of these solution, so it will have the complex number associated with the eigenvalue, which is the energy. And that satisfies the equation. DFT, Sir Hohenberg and Kahn have constituted the basis of DFT since 1964. So DFT basically based on the two fundamental mathematical theorems. So the first one, it says all of the terms in the Hamiltonian in the Schrodinger equation can be expressed also uniquely as functions of the electron density. So this means that instead of you solve for the individual electron wave function, now you can solve for the electron density, which is a function of coordinates. The second theorem, it says the energy of the system is variational with respect to the electron density. So what this means, it tells us that if the functional is known, then we can vary the electron density until the energy from the functional is minimized, and now we can have the energy of the system. So based on these two mathematical theorems, now you can express the energy term in a unique functional of electron density. So now the total energy functional can be written as two terms. First term is the known part, and the second term is the exchange correlation energy, which we talk about it a little bit more later. So looking at the known part, you already seen it. It still have those energy term, the kinetics energy of electron, interaction between nuclei electron, and interaction of, now we describe in a total electron density. It's interactions between electron and total electron density. And the second term here is the exchange correlation term. It's defined to include all the quantum mechanical effects, which is including electron self-interaction. However, making those approximation and based on this theory, we still don't know how to solve this equation. So the difficulty of to solve that has been shown by Sir Kahn and Cham and in 1965. So what they do is they showed in the task of finding the right electron density can be expressed in a way that it involves solving a set of equations in which each equation only involves a single electron. Now, this equation, what the difference from the last one is that you see the big part, the summation here, is missing. So now, the solution of this equation, can be a single electron wave function, and that depends on only three coordinates variables. And the way to solve it, they will use the iterative way. So I will show a little bit later. We still have the last term here, the exchange correlation energy term here. So this term is still include the electron cell interaction and the correction for us. This is one of the several of effects in a DFT. So that term is important. That's why when you do DFT calculation, to choose the exchange correlation functional is important. So, and actually the true form of the exchange correlation functional is not known yet. And it is a quite a big research field to actually develop a functional that can accurately represent nature exact functional and implement it in the mathematical form that can be solved efficiently for large number of atoms. So this is the key important for the exchange correlation functional. However, these days we already have many functionals that already very well described in many systems. So you probably know, for example, PW91 or PBE or RPBE. Also, to choose the exchange correlation functional to use in your system, and you already know how it can relate to your results accuracy, it also relates to your computational time. And this shows you the functional that would require, you know, the increase that would require more computational cost, but also increase your results accuracy. Okay, back to the ConChem equations. To solve this equation, so you basically start with the program start with initial electron density, guess and define an initial electron density. Then to solve for the ConChem equation, you receive the individual wave function of electron. Then you calculate from this wave function, you calculate back the electron density defined by the wave function. Once you get the new electron density, you compare to the guess one in the step one. If it's equal, then this is the ground state electron density and can be used to compute a total energy. If they are not equal, then they update the electron density and start again. So it go like this until it reach that they are equal for the electron density from step one and step three. And I think that a very brief introduction to the DFT.